action here. We have the second semi-final between two contenders here on the left side. It's Daniel Farney playing Esper Control. And on the right side, we will have Thomas Flores, who plays Scrat Red. Wow, what a nice matchup. I'm really excited to see that. And I hope you're excited too and join us for this second semi-final. Of course, both players will start with the record of 0-0 here. And we are ready for this match. So, on the left side, Daniel Farney, he's playing his match with this Esper Control deck, which is a pretty sweet deck. Also against the Phoenix decks and so on. A deck designed by Dione Alfonso and Daniel Farney. And he plays 3 Esper Charms, 1 Kaya, Arts of Usurper, main board, 2 Supreme Verdict, 2 Teferi, Hero of Dominaria, and also some action in Cryptic Commands, Engineered Explosives, main board, Fatal Pushes, Chasing Mind Sculptors, Lingering Souls, and so many things more. On the right side, there is Thomas Flores, who's playing Scrat Red. Very interesting as well. So 3 Scrat, 3 Flame Slash, 4 Lightning Bolt, 2 Magma Jet, 4 Cough of the Hanger, Chandra, and also other cards such as Storm Breath Dragon and Goblin Rebel Masters. I'm very hyped to see this match. I hope you are hyped too. And yeah, let's see. There is turn 1, land, and already can exile some cards from the opponent.
In this matchup, I really like the Scrat Red side of it. I've played Control against Scrat Red, and it's really hard to win. So it's I think Thomas has the advantage, especially if he can stick a Blood Moon. He has 4 Blood Moons, right?
He has 4 Blood Moons just in the sideboard.
Ah, yeah, just in the sideboard. Okay, yeah. So maybe pre-board is going to be a bit harder, but if he can stick a Planeswalker, it's really hard for Daniel to deal with.
So Thomas,
an aggressive sacking
to draw a card with his Relic of Progenitus and draw for a turn.
Did Thomas mulligan?
I didn't see that.
No, he didn't have a second land. I mean,
that's
you cannot keep those hands with only...
There's Hardcore Snapcaster, aggressive plan by Daniel Farney here with his Esper Control against the Scrat Red. Attack for 2. And there is Scrat dealing with Snapcaster Mage.
Yeah, 1 damage, that's enough to kill it.
Nihil Spell Bomb. So Daniel with his Esper Control is playing 2 Nihil Spellbomb.
Still no land for Thomas. Yeah, I don't know why he kept a 1 lander against Daniel.
I think against the Esper Control deck you really have to pressure. Oh,
yeah, exactly. He wants to play Planeswalker fast and win the game with it. I hope he has a Mindstone right now. Yeah, he has 1.
Yeah, there it is.
Let's see. Daniel has a Logic Knot in his place. I would play it. I think it's a bad play from Danny because he should, by countering the Mindstone, he denies mana to Thomas, who is really struggling on that side. So it gives him more turns to really take over the game.
It There is polluted delta on the side for Daniel, so now he has access to the black color as well for his Esper.
Yeah, he should have countered the Mindstone last turn, and we saw a Jace in hand. He could just play the Jace now and just win the game with Jace, and didn't do it. That's maybe a little mistake on his side. Because right now he's afraid of Thomas playing a Koth, untapping a mountain and just attacking the Jace. But he couldn't have done it if he had countered the Mindstone. So yeah, Thomas still ramping up. Second Mindstone. He'll probably try a Rebel Master or a threat of some kind.
And there will be, of course, the answer from Daniel, I guess.
Yeah, the question is now, do you counter it or do you pass to exile it?
Oh yeah.
Daniel has a pass.
We really want to give it, well, now at the moment he already has access to 5 lands, but he chooses the path.
Yeah, exactly. He keeps the counter spells for planeswalkers and has removal for the creatures.
That was definitely the right decision. So there is someone asking in the stream chat why we are doing this in English. That's because we are in Switzerland and there are also people coming from the Swiss Romandy and from Ticino, and they're also watching us. That's why we want that everyone is able to follow our stream. I hope you are familiar with that, and okay, and we try our best.
So Daniel fetching a swarm to just crack the Nahel spell bomb, just drawing a card at the end of turn. And also putting more cards in his graveyards to be able to delve for logic knots and really hard countering any play from Thomas. But yeah, it's difficult for Daniel because if he taps out, Thomas play for a planeswalker, Thomas also plays a planeswalker, and Thomas planeswalker are better than Daniel's.
So what's on top for Tom's floor is here.
Yeah, Thomas can just go on putting small threats every turn, turn after turn, and at one point Daniel won't have any counters or removals left. That's his idea. If Thomas can play an Eternal Scourge, for example, that's really hard for Daniel to completely deal with it.
Here's the try with Koth.
So that's gonna be a counter spell from Daniel.
That will not resolve. And exile one more card, so he has to pay one more. Flores, but Koth is going his way to the graveyard.
Here you see Daniel not afraid of Simeon Spirit Guide.
Another Relic of Progenitus for Thomas.
Yeah, the relic is good to remove the cards so that a logic knock cannot be that big. So yeah, at one point Daniel will try a planeswalker and Thomas needs to have an answer.
Yeah, I mean, if there is a Jace and you don't have the answer, he can always look at your draws. He can also make decisions on your draws and so on. And this, oh, here comes the fairy, Hero of Dominaria, down to the battlefield. Will we see him picking up?
Yeah, I think the fairy is better than Jace because he can survive an attack from Koth. Koth makes a mountain only 4/4. It also survives an attack from Stormbreath Dragon. And that way Daniel should be safe next turn and tap with the fairy again. And that's always huge for the control player.
More exile and draw for the turn.
So yeah, this game comes down to this turn. If Thomas can remove the planeswalker, he's in very good position to win. Otherwise, Daniel will just have too much card advantage. I think Thomas forgot to draw a card for his turn. Mana Jet, 2 damage. Ah, he's on upkeep. He's playing Mana Jet in order to find
And he
another
can
threat.
scry.
Yeah, he can scry too. That's the idea. Draws for the turn. I hope he
So
has another course in hand because it's really his best card against Daniel, and it would be not such a good idea to have discarded one and to. Oh, he doesn't have one. Yeah, I think Thomas should have waited a little bit more with his course and played bit later.
what do you think about? Oh, there it
A Rebel
is.
Master is not that bad, but Path to Exile again. He's gonna
Oh,
take care of
wow.
it.
What do you think about Stormbreath Dragon in this matchup with his protection from white?
I mean, if Thomas can put it into in the onto the battlefield, it's really good for him because Daniel probably only has either Lingering Souls to block it, and I think that's all. Yeah, he doesn't have any other solution to it.
Well, Supreme Verdict, maybe.
He doesn't play them in the main deck.
Sure, he has.
Ah, yeah, two. Sorry, didn't see that. But yeah, now Daniel fully in control of this game, having Teferi in play, drawing some more cards. Yes,
Search
Search
for
for Ascanta
Ascanta.
is more value.
He's going for options.
Yeah, I think Thomas could have played a bit differently this game and a better shot at winning. But right now it's getting really complicated for him.
And there's the shock with the Godless Shrine
Yeah,
on
life total
Daniel.
doesn't matter at all right now. I mean, Daniel has so many threats.
Wow, and this is Kaya, also Usurper.
Yeah, that's the Daniel's kill condition for this game. He hopes to exile enough cards to ultimate her.
Really interesting to see her play in Modern. I really like this because no one was really hyped afterwards, but there's so much things going on with with Kaya, the Ors of Usurper. So more lands and go.
Yeah, Daniel has Logic Knot's protection in hand.
Oh wow.
Two Planeswalkers. A nice scrying sheets. So yeah, Thomas really ne needs to put the threat on the battlefield to attack Daniel's Planeswalkers. Again, now a Koss or a Stormbreath Dragon would be perfect.
Let's see what kind of action.
Oh, he needs to draw a card
Oh.
with Mind Stone, and that's.
But at least that's the upside of Mind Stone. If the game goes longer, you can also crack it, draw a card. You have enough mana, it doesn't mind. Oh, there's another one.
Yes, of course, but right now Thomas wants to have spared mana to be able to pay for the possible Logic Knot from Daniel.
Oh, I see.
He draws again, and he found something, but Daniel's gonna Logic Knot that
Here comes the
Rebel Master.
kill.
It depends. He has another
And they
removal.
get pathed again. Wow.
Third pass.
And this is game for Daniel with his Esper control, with his Planeswalkers, Teferi, and Kaya on the board. Wow, we didn't see that. Well, we didn't see both decks before today on the feature match area, which is pretty sweet to see. Well, there was not that much action from Flores, but there would have been some action. But there was so many answers from Daniel from the left side, so there was no chance to come in the game for Thomas Flores.
Yes, so now we go to the sideboard. Daniel will probably bring in a Celestial Purge to deal with the red Planeswalkers. I also like Disdainful Stroke, Negate, two Sword Seizes, and two Annealing Clicks. Those are all really good. And he will just basically remove the Fatal Push and Explosives, probably. Maybe the Lingering Souls and the Kaya as well, because they're less good in this matchup.
Yeah, really makes sense. And on the other side, for Thomas Flores, you have an inside board 4 Blood Moon, 4 Dragon's Claw, 1 Abrade, 2 Shattering Spree, 3 Anger of the Gods, 1 Sweltering Suns. Well, I guess the Blood Moon, this is no question.
Yeah, that's going to be the story of the post-sideboard games. If Thomas can stick a nice Blood Moon and Daniel has not enough basics to continue playing, that's going to be game. Otherwise, the matchup doesn't change that much. It's still the same. Thomas needs to stick a threat, a Planeswalker or Blood Moon in play, and Daniel needs to answer every single card from Thomas, or else he's gonna die quite fast.
What do you think about Dragon's Claw?
Oh, I mean, you're probably kidding. It's gain one life each time a red spell is cast. this matchup is really not about life. Have you played once against this?
Against the Scred Red?
Scred Red, yeah.
Well, I played with John against it, of course, but it was some years ago. Well, I think it's very even then. Well, you have a lot of answers against this deck, but this is very another situation. We have an Esper control deck, which has more options as well, where you can also lay back, you can control the ground, then you can go with Teferi, or you can go with Kaya or with Jace. So it's very interesting. You can find all your threats with digging through your library with all these cantrips that you play, or with Search for Red Skanta, of course, which is a huge card for the Esper control player here.
Yeah, I still like the Scred Red side post-board. I think the threats from Thomas are really are all must answers for Daniel, and he really need the right kind of answers for every threat, otherwise he's gonna fall behind. Also, we saw it last game. Thomas has Scrying Sheets. It's a very good card against control because it ensures that you almost never draw lands, because you can just reveal them and draw them. And in this matchup, this land is really, really good. So hopefully Thomas keeps a hand with more basics.
Yeah, maybe he already knows that there will be some action coming in form of Blood Moon here from Thomas Flores. So keeping your fetch lands in hand and basic lands for sure is not a bad thing.
Yeah, Daniel will fetch aggressively for basics normally.
Opening hand again with Relic of Progenitus for Thomas Flores, hitting the battlefield. There's a Flawless Strand for Daniel.
Yeah, we see in hands Daniel has a Esper Charm.
Oh, that's huge.
Yeah, that can be quite useful.
Another fetch land.
Yeah, Daniel has two fetch lands. It's really good for him, because if now Thomas plays Blood Moon, he can fetch two basics. It's not enough to play a whole game, but that's already a beginning.
For free mana and this Goblin Rebel Master. The battlefield.
Yeah, that's the plan. Just put
and double fetch.
Try to stick a threat for Thomas. It's It'll be interesting to see if Daniel fetches for basics or not.
Oh yeah.
He's a bit afraid of Blood Moon.
Two basics here for Daniel. And no white, so that means he has no path to exile in hand. But is it maybe a fatal push?
Yeah, probably fatal push. Yep, that's the passive advantage of playing Blood Moon against your opponent. Even if you don't have it, he's afraid of Blood Moon. So here Daniel didn't fetch for a white, and it's gonna be very hard for him to go and fetch a double white if he needs to. If he wants to play a Supreme Verdict later in the game.
And Field of Ruins is also doing a good job here with two open lands. So you can shoot a land from your opponent and find your third basic land.
No, because Thomas doesn't play any... only has three non-basics. If he doesn't play the Scrying Sheets, that's...
I just mean if he doesn't find a white land, maybe. So
it yeah, but he needs a target on the Thomas side, and Thomas doesn't have one yet. We see Thomas forgetting to activate his Relic of Regenitus to tap it at the end of turn. It's a small mistake. Now cracking it to hopefully find land. Yeah, still no land for Thomas. Yeah, Daniel is now in a strange position because he has
snapcast or hardcast.
Yeah, and he has colored mana problems a little bit.
And there's a bolt from Thomas Flores against this snapcaster from Daniel Farney here in this semi-final.
Still no lands on both sides. See the players just hoping to draw one. Thomas is gonna crack the relict, hopefully finding a land. Yeah, if Thomas can just play a land, play a cost, that's gonna be huge for him. But still no lands. It's
not much going on here.
Eternal Scourge.
Ooh, wow, there it is. It's a good buddy. It's
hardest to interact with for Daniel. Swordsease on Daniel's side.
Wow, oh. Wow, what a power hand, but no mana.
Yeah, we can see if Thomas draws a force land, it's almost game over.
There will be huge swings with two Stormbrave Dragon, one Chandra, Torch of Defiance, one Cove of the Hammer, and a Mind Stone. Oh no, two Chandra, I see. Oh, he's taking out the Mind Stone to not giving too much action to Thomas Flores, and Thomas is playing with his hands revealed. This is great.
Then
for
we also
us.
See.
There is the land.
Which one do you play, Koz or Chandra?
I don't know. Well, I never played the deck, so I'm not very aware what Koz actually
does. It's a scoop, yeah. Because it's a two-turn clock, because Koz attacks for 4, plus 3 from the Scourge, it's 7. And next turn he can just play Chandra, attack for 7 again, and then he's dead. Then he knows that he has to fetch a lot if he's... drawing non-basics, Ravnica shocks, and yeah.
So we are on 1-1 in this semi-final between Esper Control and Scred Red.
And maybe you saw in Danny's hand he had a Logic Knot, but because he aggressively fetched for a Swamp to have an answer to Blood Moon, to be less weak against Blood Moon, he couldn't cast it.
I see.
And he paid for it.
So there will, I guess there will be no changes for Thomas Flores for the third game. Maybe there are some changes for Daniel, already sideboarding two cards for being on the play in this semi-final in the last game, for winning this match. And the winner, of course, will enter the final and play against Pablo Rossi with his five-color human stack, who's waiting there.
Yeah, I hope for a nice game where both play a draw, good hands, and we can have some nice interactions. Really some back and forth, some planeswalkers on each side, battling each other. It can be a really nice game to watch if both players draw normal hands.
Yeah, it's not that we have such a game like in the last one, but I mean, this is Magic, it can happen everything or anything. Yeah, sometimes you're in favor, sometimes your opponent screws, sometimes you screw, sometimes someone is flooded. But I mean, this is what Magic is also all about. And
yes,
I mean, sometimes it's in favor of you, sometimes in favor of your opponent. But well, at least I'm very happy if there is a game to watch and not just a one-sided game that just someone wins to mana flood or screw. And yeah, let's see what the third match will bring to us. So Daniel Farney is already thinking about, does he has to change something here? How can he improve the deck being on the play against Thomas Flores' Scred Red?
Yeah, this Esper control deck, it's not easy to sideboard in a matchup that Danny probably hasn't played yet, because Scred Red is not such a popular deck. And as a control player, you have many, many options with your sideboard. You really don't know what to side out and what to side in. Do you prefer a Fatal Push or Pass to Exile against Thomas?
That's definitely a good question.
And yeah, based on his experiences of both game, he might have an opinion, and but this opinion can change during the game, of course. So the two players finished shuffling,
and finally we'll have some more action here in this semi-final.
Oh, this is not an earthquake in Bern. It's just a camera shaking a little bit.
So let's stay tuned. We hope that we have no mulligan here in this final, semi-final, in the third game. The winner will head to the final here in this event. And he will have two buys for the Swiss Magic Masters in Bern in the 19th and 20th of October for Modern. So there is a mulligan for Thomas Flores going down to 6.
So what is Danny's hand? I couldn't see anything.
So Daniel keeps his hand. He has 7 mana. 7 cards. Sorry for that. It's already being late streaming for 9 hours and moderating every match, but this is great. We have some Lodging Knot action, some Snapcaster action, and well, it was very short to look at it, but we saw that there is something he could do. So there's a keep.
Keeping on top, and now Daniel again with the fetch land. Same question for him, do you go for basics because of Blood Moon, or do you try something else?
And the third time in a row, Thomas Flores with Relic of Progenitus. And there's the basic for Daniel. And he still has the Lodging Knot in his hand.
Stone, that's just acceleration for Tom. Thomas. So, the big question, do you go for basic or not?
Haha. And you really want to counter the Mind Stone?
I think it's not a bad play. Thomas has a Relic of Progenitus to exile the cards for Logic Knot, and you want to slow him down.
Nice.
And he knew that Thomas could have just answered the sacking the fetch land with the Relic of Progenitus ability.
You're definitely right.
But like it's the fifth time this match that he forgot to tap the relic, so maybe Daniel noticed that and thought, yeah, he's not gonna do it anyways because he never did it.
So maybe there will be the basic swamp here for Daniel. Yep. And what will he play? Maybe Kaya?
I think Kaya is in the sideboard. It's not a good, not a good card against Thomas.
So two blockers.
Oh, now for the first time in the game, Thomas taps the relic.
They will not do many things against the Storm Breath Dragon because of protection from white, but at least have some two threats on the battlefield. They can shake up some things, and you can also flashback to get two more. Such an amazing card, this.
Yeah, and it's actually a card that's hard to answer for Thomas, because for 1/1 flyers, that's a small army for Daniel. And yeah, you see here Thomas has to aggressively abrade one token at a time. That's
really hard for
that's
me.
Not a very good deal. And so Daniel can now untap. And he's probably. Oh.
And another Lingering Souls for Daniel. Wow! Three flyers here.
And a fetch land to go and get a basic. That's.
And there is no answer at the moment against the flashback of the Lingering Souls.
Yeah, and I think Thomas has very few answers to 5/1/1 tokens. He needs to play like a Stormbreath Dragon and hope it's good enough. I mean, what's Chandra gonna do? He can plus to deal to gain some mana or reveal some cards, but if he minuses on one token, it's gonna be dead next turn. So yeah, Thomas pluses. He didn't exile a card, he probably.
No. Maybe he made a mana.
Yeah, that's strange. You should exile a card to deal 2 damage at least.
At least.
Maybe has a Mind Stone in hand. See that. So you see the third basic from Daniel. He's almost Blood Moon proof at this point.
Oh yeah, actually. So untap.
So yeah, Thomas missed mana, but yeah, that's maybe that was a mistake. So yeah, the Daniel can now pressure the Chandra.
Field of Ruin. And he can also flashback Lingering Souls.
Yes, too.
He does.
To have even more pressure. And even though Thomas has 3 Angers of the God in the sideboard, I don't think he brought them in.
I also don't think so. I think it doesn't really make sense.
He probably wasn't expecting Lingering Souls from Daniel, and yeah, so.
So Chandra already on 2 loyalty counter, so let's see if she will survive the next turn, because there is 5 damage on board in the air from our Esper Control player Daniel Farney, who is by the way the organizer of the Modern
Oh,
League here in Bern.
that's a very good reveal with Chandra. Pierre-Kieran Allard putting also a couple of tokens into play.
I see.
So, and it sticks. So yeah, Chandra will die. But a couple of tokens from Daniel as well. Pass to
Interessant.
exile.
But there are two blockers.
But five attackers, so Chandra will die. Daniel can also filter friends the scrying sheets from Thomas to prevent any card advantage. Yeah, I think that so Daniel still has the advantage in this game. Yeah, just because of Lingering Souls, it's a very hard card to deal with for Thomas.
I see.
And he also probably wasn't expecting it from Daniel because it's not a usual card in the Esper control deck.
Oh, there he goes. Shooting the land and getting another basic here for both players. Field of Ruin doing what he can.
Yeah, Daniel probably just has a third and last island. So it's gonna be the last
Yeah, I can smooth out the
basic on his
deck.
side. Oh, Daniel is really in the driver's seat this game. He can now
Yeah,
you see the
and
two
we do.
trades for the tokens. Chandra will die.
So let's see if there will be more top deck action from our Scred Red player Thomas Flores. Will he find a Koth? Will he find a Chandra? Will he find a Stormbreath Dragon? So there are so many good cards in this deck. Didn't
I
see
think he
that
just
much
passed
action,
the
but he
turn.
passed the
Oh,
turn.
that's really bad. Esper Charm. I would like Thomas to discard two cards.
Wow. Jersey
As
Scred.
I mean, that's bad when you have to trade a Scred for a
Oh,
flying token.
he chooses to draw two cards.
That's not a solution, but I think bringing Thomas from three cards to one would be quite nice as well. Would have been quite nice as well. Draw Swordseize. Maybe shoot Swordseize first. Check.
Two more damage from the air.
Yeah, Daniel has just more cards in hand, and he's really in the commanding position this game. Yeah, what Thomas needs to come back is really a Stormbreath Dragon, and then to pump it, how do you call the ability? Getting
The
monstrous, I believe.
monstrous.
Yes, that's maybe his only solution.
If there is also no count, it's always difficult to play against these control decks.
It's strange, Daniel didn't play Swordseize.
Maybe he wants his black mana open?
But for what, though? Still no play from Thomas. Okay, flashback, Snapcaster. So let you discard two, you have no
Now,
hand.
here comes the Esper Charm and this
Exactly.
got Rebel Master and the Mountain.
Yeah, I don't understand why Thomas didn't play the Rebel Master. I mean,
Yeah.
you want to
Maybe he
hope that.
waited until he has another threat, playing both if one gets countered. And these are 4 damage.
Yes, but I think you're somehow losing anyway and just needs Daniel to have only blanks to win.
Relic of Progenitus from the top of Thomas Flores.
Daniel think about countering this. He has a negate in hand.
And there it is.
Yeah, also here Thomas doesn't sack the relic directly. I think that's a slight mistake. You want to draw three more cards and really find something to combat those Flyers.
So there will be some card draw.
I think at this point it's just a matter of time until Daniel just wins with those three small attackers.
Yeah, he has full bore, full hands. Oh.
That's not gonna help.
Losing two life from Ants passing the turn. So let's see if Thomas Flores finds an answer to this four power on board of Daniel Farney here in the semi-final. Oh, he doesn't.
Yeah, still nothing.
We didn't see any.
It looks
Stormbreath
bad.
Dragon.
And I just saw Daniel with a Logic Knot in hand.
Oh,
but
okay.
Almost nothing in the graveyard. So
he's on five. Lingering Souls Beatdown is on, paired with Snapcaster. And this is search for Ascanta.
Yeah, just helping putting more cards in the graveyard.
I see.
Then, yeah, activating scrying sheets, making sure you don't draw a land. I mean, in this deck, scrying sheets is really, really nice. It's enables you to top deck relevant spells almost every turn.
That's great.
And before Field of Ruin was printed, last year, it was even harder for the control decks to beat that because you had almost nothing.
But there's so many basics.
Yeah, that's too little too late again. Daniel is just gonna negate it. Just make sure you don't randomly die to it.
And there's Stormbreath Dragon.
Oh, that's interesting. This might.
So Thomas really waited for a second threat so he can cast one, which gets countered, and then bring a second one who is the large one of them.
Yeah, does Daniel have an answer to it? You see, Path to Exile is not good enough.
Oh, not against the big dragon.
And if the dragon gets monstrous, that's big. Yeah, this game is closer now. Daniel really has to find an answer to the Stormbreath Dragon. But I'm not sure, I don't think Thomas can already attack with the dragon.
Yeah, it's a pretty sweet card, also against the control player with the damage.
I mean, if the dragon gets monstrous, that's it becomes a 7-7, right? Plus the number of cards in Daniel's hand, that's 4 right now. It would be 11 damage. Yeah, actually, that's a big play. It can be a big play. Oh, Thomas might just be able to win with the dragon. As a control player, I hate this dragon so much because there's not a lot you can do.
So when he's able to make it monsters, it becomes a 7-7 with protection from white.
It costs 7 to...
Cost 7, right? Yeah.
So now Thomas is debating. Oh, careful, careful. He has only 6 mana open if it's not a land. I don't know what he's doing. Yeah, it was not a land, so he can not get the Dragon Monstrous this turn. On the cost. Yeah, but Daniel has Logic Knot, so he can counter it. But it's really strange that Thomas didn't just go for the monstrous dragon. Attack for 7, deal 4 more because of the 4 cards in Daniel's hand. Daniel cannot block, that's 11 damage, and next turn he's dead.
And there's the logic knot. The calf has gone.
He doesn't attack, he's scared that it's... I think Thomas is so far behind, he should be more aggressive and really try to win. Oh, that's a nice land from Daniel. It means next turn he can go for lethal.
Oh, creeping tar pit.
Creeping tar pit,
unblockable
exactly.
Threat here.
Yeah, it's a strange game where both players didn't make optimal plays both times.
Ego. For Daniel Farney.
It's a funny one from Daniel. I think he just casts it to have less cards in hand, to take less damage from the dragon getting monstrous.
Definitely makes sense.
And he can also remove like the like of Chandra or some other big threat.
Or maybe some other dragons.
Yeah, it's either the dragon or Chandra. Definitely not the...
He
Eternal
goes
Scourge.
For the dragons.
Yeah, he chose the dragons. Two dragons are gone. No, it wasn't Blood Moon.
Blood Moon trigger.
Yeah, we know in the modern league, we play every Wednesday. Daniel really hates Blood Moons, and yeah, he always gets triggered when Blood Moon is playing against, played against him.
So we're interested. What do you think, as if you would be Daniel Farney, would you attack with all your creatures?
No, not this turn. Or
at least he blocks one.
No, you want to be able
still
to
have two more for next turn. Or would this be too grindy?
I don't know. He knows he's gonna win next turn anyway.
There's a mountain on top.
Mountain draw. I think right now there's nothing Thomas can do. It's
no, okay.
No, really, the Daniel is gonna attack for 5 next turn. Or maybe he's afraid of lightning bolt, but
that could be.
No, if he
cough again.
If Thomas plays as a. Yep, that's. I think that's game over for. For Daniel. Okay, Thomas can probably survive a turn by just turning something into a creature.
So he's untapping a land, it's a creature, and he attacks with it.
So he's dead. Daniel
still
loses.
Holding back the dragon.
Yeah, but Daniel can attack for lethal. Having 5 damage on the 5 damage on the board. So just activate the land, swing for lethal, and that's it. Yeah, sad for Thomas because he had a small window to win
and
the game, but yeah, that's it.
Match.
Daniel wins and goes to the final.
Congratulations to Daniel Farney joining Pablo Rossi in the final of the Swiss Magic Masters Modern Trial here in Bern. Also, congratulations to Thomas Flores to his very good play here in this event. So we are very, very hyped for the final, so stay here. We will continue. Just in some 1, 2, or 3 minutes.